You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Theater 100. This is our class on television, film, and theater. We're in our 14th week right now. In fact, we only have one more broadcast after this week. So we're coming to the finale, the grand finale, as we call it in theater. But today we're going to look a little bit at the modern theater that we are in right now. And we're looking at costuming today, which is a great approach to understanding what goes on stage when you can see what the actors are wearing. We're also going to look at a unique film, our final film of the semester, The Great Debaters. I hope you've seen that film in the past, and it may not be brand new to you, but if so, hopefully you'll go and see it this weekend. It's a great show. So 1-800-339-1193 gets you anywhere from North America into our booth here if you want to ask a question or comment on what we're talking about, or go online to askdhtv@gmail.com. Askdhtvlive@gmail.com, and you can post a response to us. Do want to just alert my students that since we are coming to the grand finale, there's a lot of things going on. We are doing there's no quiz this week. That's because students are literally right now finishing their final writing assignment for the semester, which is their play review. So that is due by tonight. But we do have a discussion board this week, our 8th discussion board and our last discussion board. So that's due by Friday night. And you'll see some discussion board focus items in this broadcast that you can respond to. But I also want to warn you that next week, in addition to being the final week where we're going to look at lighting and sound, we are also giving you the chance to do the final exam. So feel free to go onto the website, our Blackboard site, to see the different chapters 3, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, and 14, as well as film items that we've covered. And also, you may want to know that the final exam has no essays. So that's great news. It's all multiple choice and true and false. So it's quick and easy, but you get to do it anytime between 9 o'clock on May 7th, next Monday, or midnight, May 11th, the next Friday. So that's when the final exam, and that's the conclusion of our whole semester. So yes, a lot happening right now for our students in Theater 100. So one of the discussion board focus items that I just mentioned will be on costumes. So what kind of information does our clothes convey about us? What do we learn about ourselves or about another person by how they are dressed? So this is a good focus item for you to write about, or if you would like to respond even today during the broadcast. We are an interactive medium, so we'd love to hear from you. But yes, what kind of information do we get from just what we wear, what kind of clothes we wear? So that's one of our discussion board focus items. All right, a little bit about the history. As you know, for Theater 100, we tend to look a little bit back in order to help us look at what we're doing today in contrast. And sometimes it's not so contrasting, and that is very true of 20th century theater, as we're going to look at how we reacted against realism. By the 1860s, 1870s, realism had become very much the new style, an international style, if you will. It really conquered all. And there was also a counter-reaction to it. We'll look at that in a minute. But you could go and see a show, for instance, at David Belasco's Theater on Fifth Avenue in New York, and see The Child's Restaurant. This is a production of a show called The Governor's Lady. And you could actually see a scene set at Child's Restaurant, which is only a couple blocks away, I think at 57th and Madison. And he duplicated it exactly so that audiences who had gone to the the restaurant and maybe had dinner there, could go to the theater and now see it duplicated exactly. Audiences were fascinated with realism. They loved seeing the real world duplicated on stage. And that was new, hadn't been that way since the beginning of theater. Theater had always been very presentational, not representational, but now it certainly was, especially with the works of playwrights like Eugene O'Neill. Eugene O'Neill was perhaps the first great American writer. He's sometimes talked about as being the first, the father of American drama. At the beginning of the 20th century, he was writing plays that looked at how dysfunctional we are as families. Many of his plays are searing looks at the psychological breakup of individuals and the tortured relationships in families. But it went hand in hand with what Freud and Jung were looking at that time. So his plays, O'Neill, were very psychologically deep and disturbing. But that made it quite realistic for people. People really identified in his plays. And though he had many expressionistic plays like Emperor Jones, O'Neill, as well as the many playwrights who followed him, like Tennessee Williams and Lorraine Hansberry, wrote in a much more realistic mode, which was comfortable for most Americans. I mentioned Tennessee Williams. It would be wrong to talk about realism without getting a little bit of a look at his Streetcar Named Desire, which was a beautifully poetic work. This wasn't done until the 1940s, but it does represent the fascination that Americans especially had with the kind of psychosexual neuroses that Tennessee Williams' characters had. So this is the famous story of Blanche DuBois, who comes away from what had been this beautiful plantation in Belle Reve to kind of move in with her sister in New Orleans and her husband, Stanley Kowalski, to find out that beauty does not really exist too much in America anymore. And the way that things were done in the past are no longer done in the more sophisticated way that she's accustomed to. So when she first meets Stanley Kowalski, we get the contrast of these two very different characters. Blanche, who's sophisticated and comes from a much more cultured and privileged world, and Stanley, who is coming from much more of a working class, robust, athletic, masculine background. So you'll see the contrast in them in this little opening clip from Streetcar Named Desire.
You must be Stanley. I'm Blanche.
Oh, you're still sister.
Yes.
Oh, hi. Yeah, where's the woman?
In the bathroom.
Oh. Well, where are you from, Blanche?
I live in Oriel.
Oriel. Oriel, huh? Oh, yeah, that's right. Oriel, that's not my territory. Man, look at going fast in the hot weather. You want a shot?
No, I rarely touch it.
Well, there's some people that rarely touch it, but it touches them often. Hey, you mind if I make myself comfortable? My shirt is sticking.
Please, please do.
Be comfortable, that's my motto, up where I come from.
It's mine too. It's hard to stay looking fresh in hot weather when I haven't washed or even powdered. Here you are.
Well, you know, you gotta be careful. You're sitting around a damn thing, catch a cold. Especially when you've been exercising the heart like Bowen is. Well, you're the teacher, aren't you?
Yes.
What do you teach?
English.
Oh, I never was very good English student. How long are you here for?
Well, I don't know yet.
You gonna shack up here?
I thought I would if it's not inconvenient for you all. Traveling wears me out.
Well, take it easy.
What's that?
Not those cats. Hey, Stella! What'd you do, fall asleep in there? Huh? Well, I guess I'm going to strike you as being the unrefined type, huh? You know, Stella spoke a good deal about you. She said you were married once, weren't you?
Yes. Well, I was quite young.
Celia Kazan, who directed it, now goes into this whole memory that she has of losing her first husband. That's Marlon Brando at his best, in his t-shirt that was designed for him so that he could have that muscular look. And that's Vivian Leigh doing, I mean, it's amazing that she also did Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind, two of the most classic American female leads, Blanche DuBois as well as Scarlett O'Hara. They were quite a match. But you could see, even in little things like Brando scratching his back, just the costuming too, the detailing in the costuming, realism was exactly what audiences loved to see. They loved to see their lives on stage. That's what it was for most people. So, and it's still true. Even if we go see a movie that takes place in a future world, we want to see it realistically. So it established something of a perennial style for all of theater. But what's odd, historically, at the beginning of the 20th century, especially when we have World War I and all of this insanity of people gassing each other, millions dying in World War I, society felt that realism didn't really get to the truth. I mean, that's a kind of an amazing concept, that they felt that you were able to speak more artistically and politically and philosophically when you used symbolism, different kinds of subjective truths, spiritual connections, mysterious connections came from forms of theater that were not realistic. So we actually get a reaction against realism in the early 1900s, 1920s, where we get such a variety of different kinds of shows. This, for instance, this wonderful image here, is Edward Gordon Craig was a designer who wanted to do something different than just duplicate everyday reality. So this is a production of Hamlet that he did with the famous director Konstantin Stanislavski, famous for his naturalistic acting techniques. And this is done at the Moscow Art Theater in Moscow. Craig went up there to do this show. And what Craig built, as you can see, they look like columns. It looks like you're at a palace. There's a whole step unit there. But they are actually screens that move. In other words, in between scenes, those screens would go into a different alignment and give us maybe a different kind of portion of the palace. But it was all done with, now lighting was very new to the theater, and there was more three-dimensionality in a lot of the stage sets. But it was done to create more of a kind of universal appeal, a kind of feeling of light and shadow playing upon the imagination. That's what Craig was really after. So here's this English designer who was very inspired by that. We also have in Russia at the time, directors like Meyerhold. Meyerhold wanted a theater that was totally anti-realistic, so he would put together ladders and ramps and trapezes and turning wheels. This is a production of his Magnanimous Cuckold, a production that was done in 1923. And in fact, it's called constructivism, which was an artistic style at the time, not just in Russia, but all over. Constructivism was like taking ramps and a kind of a collage. Collage was very new at the time for artists. There was Duchamp and a number of famous artists who were experimenting, Picasso himself, with a collage, different items actually placed onto a canvas. Well, constructivism did the same thing, but in theater, it involved creating a sense of place, but it wasn't really any particular place. It served for many other places. So Meyerhold would have his actors doing all kinds of very highly physicalized actions on these ramps and trapezes you're seeing here. He wanted actors to act from above. They were actually using vertical space, not just staying on the stage floor. So a lot of his techniques were designed to move away from this fascination with realism. Meanwhile, in Germany, we have Bertolt Brecht, another director, playwright, who is creating epic theater. It's called epic theater because of the way that it moved away from, this is actually from Theater of the Absurd, this is Waiting for Godot, but what I'm talking about with Brecht, I don't think we have a slide for, but he removed the proscenium arch. He didn't want the audience to think we were in some mysterious place. He wanted them to know that they were in a theater. So the stage managers would actually be on stage. You would see lighting instruments exposed there. So the audience, nothing was masked, meaning hidden from view by the technicians. When he did The Good Woman of Szechuan, for instance, he actually had the actors in masks because he felt that when actors are in masks, the audience are forced to kind of think about the issues in the play. They're not kind of looking at how beautiful that actress was. They're not carried away into some mysterious world. They're being forced to deal with realities. And of course, in 1920s in Germany, there were some harsh realities, which later led to the rise of Hitler and the Nazi regime. So Brecht was very much a socialist. He wanted to bring more power to the people, and he was against capitalism. So his Marxism didn't make him too popular in America, but it gave him a new concept of looking at theater that was not realistic. Much later on, we even get, in Europe, Theater of the Absurd, which I think we have that image from Waiting for Godot. This is where we really move away from all forms of realism. So now you're looking at two tramps who are stuck in this world that they can never exit. There's a tree there, but it looks like it's falling apart. And they talk about leaving, of getting up and going, but they never go anywhere. In fact, it's very much an image of hopelessness, which for post-World War II Europe was very true. Not true of America after World War II. They were in a much different framework. But this is where the whole development of the philosophy known as existentialism comes from, where people like Jean-Paul Sartre are saying that human beings are condemned to be free, that they have no real potential for action of affecting some kind of change in life. So it was a much bleaker view of the world. And again, America was not into that. America was into Tennessee Williams in the 1940s, 1950s. But Theater of the Absurd, whether it's an Ionesco play like Rhinoceros, where little by little all the people of the town turn into a rhinoceros, I mean, that's as ludicrous as it sounds, that is what happens in the play. There are many plays that look like they happen after a nuclear disaster. So Theater of the Absurd was perhaps one of the greatest attempts to move away from realism. Next week, when we talk a little bit about the 60s, you'll see how that fascination lives on in the work of people like the Living Theater, where we now have a lot of groups in America and worldwide who are fighting against the Vietnam War, fighting against the oppression of Hispanic American minorities, and using theater, anti-realistic theater, to advance a political or philosophical point. But it's interesting. Many believe that realism doesn't actually give you the truth. I mean, that's a hard thing to imagine to some extent. But when you really think of it, what is spiritual and subjective truth in our lives, but not very realistic? So this debate will always go on as to whether our theater should look exactly like you and me, the way we look now on stage, or whether it should look like maybe our imagined selves in the future. That debate will always go on in theater. Okay, so we want to talk about this week costumes, because costumes is one of the most unique areas of design. And I say unique only because it's so easy to relate to. That was our discussion board focus question here. What kind of information do our clothes convey? And I'm sure you're very aware, without even having to read what our Edwin Wilson writes about in our chapter, is that we definitely get an understanding of a person's social position and status by how they dress. We obviously can tell whether they're male or female, maybe not so sometimes, of course, but we can tell their occupation. Clothes can tell us whether you're just coming from work or whether you're going out for a social time. In fact, sometimes it could be quite flamboyant, as you're seeing in this wonderful image here, especially the central character with color accenting his coat there. But clothing can actually show how modest you are as well. So there's a lot of information that we get. You can tell how independent a person is or how regimented they are by how they dress. Whether a person is kind of in a leisurely, casual way, you get a lot of information about their characters, or you may get an idea of where they're heading. They may be going to something that is a dress-up. Obviously, you don't wear a prom dress every day. There's only one day that you wear your prom dress. Oh, there. This is from Beauty and the Beast, but that's almost close to a prom dress. That's a very good choice. Yeah, that's not everyday wear that you're seeing there. But costumes really are a reflection of who we are. And when you think about it, in theater, what else does an audience really watch? You can choose to look up at the scenery. You can choose to maybe catch a little bit of what that light is doing. But if you're following the story, you have to watch the characters. So inevitably, you are looking at costumes all the time. Costumes are probably the best way to not only show character in a show, but to kind of create the sense of the world that we are in. It gives us a feeling that we're in some special place. Obviously, that image tells us that right away. You know, it's often said that costumes are living scenery, which is a great way of putting it. When you see how a person is dressed, you kind of know where we are. It tells you what they're heading towards, perhaps, but it gives you a little feeling of locating the world of the play. I'm going to give you a great example of this, which my students are right now finishing off their play analysis papers, which some of them have already written, and I'm going to probably shock Clarissa De La Torre by reading from her paper that she just recently handed in. But this is a perfect example of exactly what I mean. She went to see our show In the Next Room, which was done here at the University Theater, and this is her review, her reaction to the show. She goes into such depth on the costumes, but notice how she is using the costumes to give us a sense of where we are in terms of establishing a sense of historical time and place. Clarissa is doing this beautifully. I quote, "One of the aspects that made the play stand out was the costumes that were used in the play. The play took place during the Victorian era, so ideally the design of the costumes needed to look Victorian. In the play, women wore dresses that were tight around the chest and waist, and the bottom half of the dresses were loose. In fact, some of the women had embroidered designs around their dresses. The women in the play also carried hats on their heads as an accessory. The men in the play wore suits with a combination of a vest, a tailcoat, tie, bow, and black hats. In fact, some of the men even wore pants with plaid patterns. Clearly, all the characters wore traditional Victorian-style clothing. In plays, the costumes are essential because it brings life to the play. It is crucial that the play has appropriate costumes because it creates a more realistic visual for the audience. The play would not have made sense if the characters had been wearing 21st century clothing. By wearing Victorian clothing, the audience was able to have a better context for the play. Overall, it was pleasant to watch because the costumes fit so well with theme." Thank you, Clarissa, for sharing that. I know I'm surprising you by having read from your paper, but that is a perfect example of how costumes are living scenery. They actually set the world of the play as well. And you know that there are a number of shows that happen in arena where the audience is sitting around a central performing space. Maybe you didn't have a budget to build sets and scenery. So the best way of setting the location, the time, the period, is to use costumes. And a lot of good arena productions, if it's Oscar Wilde's Importance of Being Earnest, for instance, are done in arena so that the focus can really be on the characters and the costumes. So again, thank you, Clarissa, for showing that. You know, in terms of the whole history of costumes, one of the things that's nice working with a costume designer is that they are like walking encyclopedias. They really understand period style. So as you go through the periods of history, you can really tell a lot about the people living in that time. You can tell the social norms by the actual costumes. This is a great example right here. This is the Charioteer of Delphi. Now, this is a sculpture, obviously, but when it was reassembled, because it was all found broken up and then reassembled, we get this look of utter simplicity, a bold kind of simplicity in the way that the fabric is draped and falls. This is known as a chiton, and it was used actually in performance by the actors. But one of the unique things about this, I don't know if you can notice, that skirt section of the charioteer, it is fluted. And by fluted, I mean that you can see light hitting the one part that kind of stands up, and then there's a shadowy area where you've got the valley section, and then it goes up to another peak. This is called fluting. And the Greeks, actually, if you looked at the Parthenon, you would see the pillars, the these wonderful Greek Ionic sculptures, the pillars on the outside of the Parthenon, they were fluted. And it gave you a sense that when light hit it, you would see depth. It wouldn't just be a flat image. So the Greeks were famous at using very simple solutions to creating something that you could see in an epic, clear way. The Parthenon is a perfect example of that. But that's the Charioteer of Delphi. It says everything about Greek society at the time. Jump ahead to Elizabethan times and take an image of someone like Sir Walter Raleigh. Now, this costume, this is Sir Walter Raleigh and his son, actually, this is from 1590. But it almost looks like their costumes were attached to an air pump and they were like blown up so that their doublet and hose stands away from their body and gives them a really strong sense of a kind of aggressive, powerful image. And even though this is Elizabethan, the characters are Elizabethan, the style, the fashion was actually from Spain. And Spain at that era was a very aggressive culture. This is Spain of the Spanish Inquisition. This is Spain that marched into Mexico and to Mesoamerica. So a lot of the fashions of that time in Spain that then moved to other countries reflected this kind of powerful aggressiveness. So costumes tell you the whole story of the individual character and the culture behind it. Fast forward a couple years to the late 19th century into Europe, and you'll see Princess Elizabeth of Austria. This is obviously a beautiful use of fans and shawls. She was known to kind of hide away her beauty from society. She'd wear umbrellas and these fans. She didn't want to be part of the real ugly political world, so she dressed like she was in some kind of heaven of her own. She struggled very hard to maintain her beauty. In fact, she had her lower ribs removed so that she could have this very tight, corseted waist. So it was all done to reflect this kind of ethereal, otherworld beauty that was not of this world at all. So, I mean, that reflects the kind of propriety of upper-class society in the way the Elizabeth is adorned there. If you take us into the 20th century and you give us a little look at some of the flappers, now this is a great image. All of a sudden, we are seeing women's legs. We have never seen women's legs throughout history. And the flapper idea is one to express openly the new independence of women. This is ideal for shows like Noel Coward's Design for Living or anything that has a kind of Art Deco world. The flapper sensibility with those cloche hats and the nice tight skirts, dancing to jazz music, drinking gin while they're doing it. This is all 1920s. We looked at the movie Chicago in this class, so I think you can reflect pretty easily how the styles of costumes really tell us the world of the 1920s. So I think it's an easy sell pretty much to let you know how important costumes were to giving us a sense of just where we were and what time we were. And this brings up another discussion board focus item that I'd like to to pose to you, in addition to that question about what clothes tell us about ourselves or about someone else, let's use this for this week too. So if students want to write about this, in Wilson, he lists the objectives of costume design and he talks about what's required. So if you want to pick one of the seven requirements that Wilson talks about in the textbook of what stage costumes should meet, feel free to do that. That would be a great discussion board focus item. But just one, okay? There are seven there. Don't talk about all seven of them or just two. See if you can go into depth and give examples of one. So Wilson talks a lot about establishing the style of the show. Obviously, if you're going to do something by Noel Coward of the 1920s, or if you're going to do the play Chicago, you want that kind of flapper look to establish the style of the play. Wilson talks about location and period, details of character and relationship. So all of these requirements are very good to really understand what goes into costuming. And we're going to talk a little bit about the technical needs too, because one of the most unique things about costumes is that it has to fit a particular human being. You don't just do your sketches and say, oh, it looks great. You have to fashion it to the person who's going to wear the costume. So you have to know all kinds of measurements. The fittings get very elaborate. And then there's blending it with the overall design. So these requirements are terrific. They are Wilson's main statement in the textbook. But yeah, if you want to use that as your discussion board focus item, that would be great. And one of the items that he brings up is costumes as character. After all, this has to be the main thing that a good costume designer uses when they study the script, take notes about whatever changes happen. But most importantly, a good costume designer knows how to understand the character very well before they start deciding what kind of fabric they want to choose to use for the costume they're going to make for that person. So character really does lead the way in terms of design. And as we've already talked, position, your sex, your occupation, how flamboyant or modest you are, how much independence or regimentation you have, what is your purpose, your goal? These are all factors that go into what a costume designer will look at. Costume designers talk a lot about silhouettes. How far apart from the body is the actual costume? Is that, as in that Sir Walter Raleigh image? Sometimes, as in the flapper world, the silhouette gets much closer to the actor. So usually highly stylized plays have that. And cloth itself has human qualities. It's very important to realize that aspect as well. So you wouldn't put someone like Anne Frank in a taffeta piece of fabric. That's something you would reserve for someone who's going to a cocktail party, right? So sometimes it's even the fabric that tells you that. But that image of Louis XIV was a great example, for instance, of the flamboyance of the character. Obviously, Louis, who's wearing lace on his sleeves and showing off his wig and and his walking cane. He was very big on accessories as well. That was true Louis. But that was designed to kind of reek of elegance, right, when Louis XIV was there. Whereas I did a production a couple years ago called Electricidad, which was based on the famous Greek show. But in there, we had a gang mom. In other words, she had been married to the leader of a gang. And this is what she looked like. This is Clemencia. She was a hard chola. That's how she was actually referred to in the play. She was actually a murderer herself. But this is a very different style of flamboyance. This is a tough, kind of unique style. And in contrast to her, for instance, outside of her home, we had the vecinas. The vecinas were the neighborhood ladies, And they dressed in a, this, you wouldn't call this flamboyant at all, right? This is a portrait of modesty, perhaps, of the neighbors. In fact, they always had their brooms with them, their aprons. They are working ladies, kind of eager to make sure that the neighborhood stays clean. So this is a great example of a contrast. And look how you can clearly understand occupation, social setting in terms of their status, by what they are wearing. And if you were to see a man, for instance, in overalls, you definitely get the idea that this person is someone who has an occupation, just as these ladies seem to be at work all the time, even though they're at home trying to clean up the neighborhood. If you saw a woman, for instance, wearing a lab coat, I think Wilson uses this example as well. You might want to say, oh, well, that's probably someone who works in a technical job. Maybe she's a beauty salon, or maybe she's a doctor. And I think Wilson gives the example, if you want to make sure that the audience gets that it's a doctor, then you want to put that stethoscope around her neck. A good costumer wants to make sure that the audience gets the actual occupation clearly, that the person is working on. So yes, you can see how independent or how regimented the character is as well. We did a production here last year called She Kills Monsters, and it has this fascinating detour where the central character gets to kind of go into a world that is based on Dungeons and Dragons, where you get to kind of be your own avatar. So once you have this pike that you're able to fight people with and this very kind of sexy leather outfit, we know that here is someone who is quite independent and can take care of herself, right? This is not someone who is really suffering or who needs comfort. This is these are self-sufficient ladies right here. Whereas if you look at another show, we did a show, for instance, called The Brenda Project, which was about women who had survived breast cancer. In fact, we actually interviewed women to get a lot of the storyline. I think you can see from the image of this character that this is someone who is suffering and definitely needs some kind of comforting. And it's there in the wonderful blanket there, the headscarf, just the way she's holding her hands around this sweater. Everything is kind of soft in terms of the cloth that's being used. So costumers have so much power in terms of projecting who is doing what. Just a couple more examples. If you're doing Molière, you're usually doing something that is a little flamboyant because he wrote for Louis XIV. If you're doing a play like The Doctor in Spite of Himself, you are even portraying peasant ladies with a sense of style. So this is a good example from Molière's Doctor in Spite of Himself, which we did a number of years ago. And it just says who these characters are by the kind of velour quality here of the aristocrat talking to this this woman. Whereas if you look at Anton Chekhov's plays, which we looked at just a little while ago, you're looking at characters who are much more sophisticated and humble in a way. So this image from The Three Sisters is a beautiful example of this wonderful lace blouse that she's wearing expresses all of the kind of sophistication and grandeur of this aristocratic lady. Of course, the teacup helps establish that as well. And it's important to realize, too, that a good costumer knows how to put together an ensemble. An ensemble means how you see all of them together. So if you want to have a group of policemen out on stage, they all have to wear the same idea there, right, to locate them. But you may want to separate who is your lead character from the group. So that happens quite a lot, too, when you want to make sure that, let's say, Romeo is going to stand out from his buddies. And a good costumer knows how to maybe put Romeo in colors or a texture that's going to have him stand out away from Benvolio and Mercutio. So a good costumer knows how to tell you the story of who's who on stage. That is crucial. And it depends on how the play is written. If it's a play that has a lot of two or three character scenes, you can go with bolder colors. But if you've got 15 characters in every scene, too much color is going to be overpowering. So a good costumer really knows how to use all of the aspects here. Another item is just movement. Oddly enough, a lot of actors aren't totally sure how to wear a shawl, for instance. So sometimes costume designers and directors have to work with an actor on how you would use a shawl so that it can be gracefully done on stage. So a lot of the period pieces that you might be using really have to have a sense of movement. Costumes move. They're not like scenery that just stands there. So you have to give costumes a little sense of the style that they deserve, right? Because if an actor can't use a costume well, it can be a real mess. This is an image from one of our productions of For Colored Girls, which is really requiring a lot of movement. And as you can see, this actress was caught mid-movement, and in a wonderful blouse like that, you certainly want to give them a lot of movement to show off that wonderful outfit. We have images of a lot of actors from our shows, for instance, that can help show the period style. We have a show from, this is from Lysistrata, which was done in modern dress. Clearly, this is something that reflects a sense of elegance and style and sophistication. Whereas if you want to show men at work in kind of a hardened situation, as we did in our show of Jitney, this clearly tells you that these men are working a job. You actually are seeing 60 styles there, so you get a sense of when this show takes place, not just where. And sometimes a designer will draw silhouettes from the period, but use contemporary materials to give it an updated look. We've done that in our productions, for instance, of Revengers. Here's a great shot from Spring Awakening, which is a very unusual show, a modern musical, but it takes place in the 1890s. So the costumes have to recreate that world, even though these boys are dancing and singing to pretty strong modern style of music. But yeah, we had a production of Revengers Tragedy, for instance, where this is a classic line for the Duchess here, but she's also wearing leather, and a lot of the cut and the materials are pretty modern. And that was a wonderful use of modern materials mixed with classical styles. So a costumer's work is very unique, and whether they are pulling costumes or creating it, a pulled costume obviously is when the costume designer walks down to the stock, or in our case, Karen Jacobs, for instance, has her own rental areas, and she will often drive to those and look. She has to have an idea of what she's looking for at first, and she might pull a costume that she'll use for one of our shows. That may sound, you know, uninteresting, but sometimes the changes that have to be done by your stitchers or whatever can be very elaborate to fit it to that specific actor again. And obviously the costume designer loves to build the costume from scratch, and that has a lot to do with the designer's understanding of line and color and fabric. I mean, these are the basic tools that a good designer works from. And I think Wilson mentions, for instance, the idea of a muslin mock-up, that sometimes they'll actually create a costume that is kind of like a trial costume out of muslin, but they'll actually use those pieces to cut the actual fabric once they decide on what kind of fabric they're going to use for it. So there's a long process of collaboration with the director, the other designers as well, that goes into the sketches, the renderings, even this model idea, the mock-ups. until we get a fully realized costume. And then there are changes even to those costumes once we start working with it in rehearsal. There's could be many changes as well. I don't want to forget also that makeup is character and usually is tied into costuming, although they are entirely separate fields. But we have a wonderful costume designer who also is a great makeup artist. Those things, your idea, you're lucky if you have one person who can do both. But you'll hear a lot of actors say that they really don't feel the role until they get their makeup on. And there's something about the transformation of your own face into a more theatrical feeling once you have makeup on. That is very true. And realize that makeup is not just a covering, it establishes character. So if you're playing Romeo, you want to set your eyes in your makeup so that the eyes look far apart, so that you kind of have a lover's look. Whereas if you're going to be playing Sherlock Holmes, you want to have bushy eyebrows and you want the makeup to make your eyes look like caverns where you have, and you want to accentuate your forehead because he's a very thinking person, right? So, and there's obviously all kinds of fabulous makeup when you have to go into exaggerated characters like this image here or any kind of horror movies. So yeah, all the great Lon Chaneys of the world, these are the ones who helped establish a lot of the Hollywood standards that we still use today for stage makeup or film makeup for actors. But yeah, there's a lot that goes into costumes and makeup, and it really is a tool for a good director to understand how it sets the scene for the audience. It doesn't just establish character, it places us where we want to be. So I've enjoyed talking with you about costumes and a little bit about the history. And thank you to the booth for bringing all those wonderful images. It really helps to see those images that tell us who a character is. But in the second half, I hope you'll join us for this wonderful film. We're going to look at The Great Debaters, which came out in 2007, a Denzel Washington product that speaks a lot about the value of education. So I'm going to be pushing a theme, I guess, with this. But it's beautifully made. So I hope you'll join us in the second half for The Great Debaters.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man is able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes, and my home life, I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mara Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The certificate program in social media strategies and content marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
$250,000 equity investment in my company. In return, you'll get 10%.
How are we going to fund this? We are going to be a nonprofit organization. We are looking to the Gates Foundation to help us cover our costs.
What we'd like to do is to bring out a product, a video game, that we can bring to market that will have educational value, and what we like to call is edutainment.
Money is going to be used for retail stores, so 50% strictly for retail store inventory, another 20% for retail marketing support.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Welcome you to our campus, the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm Dr. Hamden, and it gives me great pleasure today to welcome you to our very first STEM in Action event. All right, let the fun begin.
There you go.
Time of your life today. As I look at you, I look at the future doctors, the future astronauts, the future math and science teachers. This is where STEM happens. This is where STEM comes alive.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, Bill DeLuca back at Theater 100. Hope you'll join us to look at The Great Debaters, which is an interesting film, came out in 2007. It was the work of Denzel Washington, and he obviously worked with Oprah Winfrey and her Harpo Productions to pull this off. It was really a beautiful film that showed the impact of education on our lives, even though it takes place in Texas in the 1930s. One of the things that it does so beautifully is it uses music throughout the show. Denzel Washington supposedly went through 1,000 different pieces of music to try to recreate the world of the 1920s and 30s from so many examples of blues and gospel songs. And as you'll see, if you hopefully see the music, that is a beautiful part of the show. In fact, the show opens with a good example of continuity using music, where a song is called, by the name of My Soul is a Witness, is played. But its playing is what helps us segue between what is really this wild party down by the river, and a prayer meeting that is held for the students at Wiley College, which is a much more somber affair. But the splicing in between the two scenes using that music makes it work quite beautifully, and that is something that Washington, as well as the production designer David Bomba, use throughout the show. Quite effectively. The film is basically about Melvin Tolson, who is an actual historical person. He was the debate coach at the historically black Wiley College in Marshall, Texas. He was also a major African-American poet. His works are actually housed at the Library of Congress, so he has quite a heritage there. But it was his desire to give his students equal place with the white students who were doing debate at that time. And this is during a world where lynching mobs were common in Texas, mid-1930s. But the film takes us all the way up to the eventual moment that the debate team wins so many shows, debates, that they go to Harvard to compete against the students there. It actually wasn't historically true, but historically they actually went to USC out here. But Harvard in the film must have sounded better in terms of it being an elevated challenge. Langston Hughes, the famous poet of the Harlem Renaissance, actually wrote about Melvin Tolson and said that he is the most famous Negro professor in the Southwest. Students all over the part of the world speak of him, revere him, remember him, and love him. And you can certainly tell it from Denzel Washington's impassioned performance of Tolson. In fact, Washington donated $1 million to Wiley College afterwards to help reestablish their debate team. So obviously he was on a mission with this show. The show also depicts some other famous historical characters like James L. Farmer Jr., who was 14 years old at the time, who came out of high school and joined this debate team that Melvin Tolson put together. Farmer would later go on to create the Congress of Racial Equality, so major figure historically. Another character, Samantha Book, is in the movie a representation of Henrietta Bell Wells, who was the first female member of the 1930 debate team at Wiley College, and she did participate in the first collegiate interracial debate in the United States. So the film is historical, and it draws on some great traditions. But I want to introduce you to Tolson's style of leadership, which is beautifully done in this opening scene. This is the audition scene where the students are allowed to try out for the team. Notice, though, in Washington's performance, how he represents Tolson as being very demanding, very accurate, very perceptive, and quite a challenge to his students. Also, note how the opening has James Farmer running to the auditions. He's late, but you're actually hearing the voice of Denzel Washington speaking at the meeting. So you have two scenes that are happening simultaneously. That kind of overlapping of film is used as a splice a number of times in the film, and it serves just as continuity. It helps link scenes together. All right, so here is the audition scene at Tolson's from The Great Debaters.
Of the 360 students here at Wiley College, only 45 of you were brave enough to try out for the debate team. Of that 45, only 4 of you will remain standing when the tryouts are over. Why? Because debate is blood sport. It's combat. But your weapons are words. Come on in. Now that Mr. Farmer has joined us, we can begin. Sit down, Mr. Farmer. Not right there. Over there.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right this way.
Good evening, Miss Tolson.
Evening.
We're waiting for you, Mr. Farmer.
I'm going, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Farmer. You smell very good, Mr. Farmer.
Thank you, sir.
You're very welcome. Gentlemen and lady, this is the hot spot. You will enter it at your own risk.
Mr. Tolson, what about the debaters from last
Don't ask a question you already know the answer to. Get up here. You'll be first. Get right here. Hot spot. Debate starts with a proposition, with an idea, resolve. Child labor should be regulated by the federal government. The first debater argues the affirmative. Affirmative means that you are for something. Mr. Reed will argue the affirmative. The second debater argues the negative. Negative means that you are what?
Against.
Brilliant, Mr. Burgess. You shall argue the affirmative, Mr. Reed. Go.
Well, sir, I begin with a quote from the poet Cleghorn. The golf links lie so near the mill that almost every day the laboring children can look out and
watch the men at play. Is that what you learned from last year, Mr. Reed? To start something and not finish it? Is it?
No, sir.
Sit down. Who's next? You? Stand up. Stand up. It's getting late. How much longer can you hide?
I'm not hiding, sir. I transferred from my college just to come here and try out for you.
I'm deeply moved. What's your name?
It's
Samantha Book.
Book?
With an E.
Arise, Miss Book, with an E. Into the hot spot, Miss Book, with an E. You know, there's never been a female on the debating team, ever.
Yes, sir, I know that.
What makes you think you should be the first?
Because, sir, I am just as qualified as anybody else here. My gender
Resolve.
Has nothing.
Welfare discourages hard work. You'll argue the negative.
All right.
Welfare takes away a man's strongest reason for working, which is survival. And that weakens the will of the poor. How would you rebut that, Miss Book, with me?
I would say it does not. Most of the New Deal goes to children anyway, and to the handicapped, and to old people.
Is that fact or conjecture?
It is a fact.
Speak up.
It is a fact.
What's your source?
The President.
Of the United States?
Yes, sir.
That's your primary source. You spoke to President Roosevelt personally.
Of course not. I did not speak to him personally, but I listened to his fireside chat.
Oh, a radio broadcast.
Yes.
Any other sources? Any other sources?
Yes, there are other sources. Like that look in a mother's eyes when she can't feed her kids. Without welfare, Mr. Tolson, people would be starving.
Who's starving, Miss Booker?
The unemployed are starving.
Mr. Burgess here, he's unemployed. Obviously, he's not starving. I drew you in, Miss Book. You gave a faulty premise, so your syllogism fell apart.
Syllogism?
Your logic fell apart. Major premise, the unemployed are starving. Minor premise, Mr. Burgess is unemployed. Conclusion, Mr. Burgess is starving. Your major premise was based on a faulty assumption. Classic fallacy. Who's next?
You all right?
Tell us your name.
I'm Henry Lowe, with an E.
All right, Mr. Lowe. I will name a subject. You speak a few words, a pertinent quote from world literature.
Go ahead.
Beauty.
I heard the old men say, all that is beautiful drifts away like the waters.
Very good. History. And name the author this time.
History is a nightmare from which I'm trying to awake. James Joyce.
Self-pity.
I never saw a wild thing sorry for itself. D.H. Lawrence.
I love D.H. Lawrence. Have you ever read?
Mr. Farmer.
Yes, sir.
I have eyes in the back of my head and ears on both sides. Stand up. Tell me the irony in the name Bethlehem Steel Corporation.
Bethlehem is the birthplace of Jesus, Prince of Peace, and Bethlehem Steel makes weapons of war.
Very good. Sit down. Who's next?
You can see how demanding he is on his students. And since it's about debate, the dialogue is very terse, very concise, like that explanation that Farmer just had to give for Bethlehem Steel. Everything is, well, as he says in the beginning of the scene, debate is a blood sport, but your weapons are words. And that stays true to the whole film. Yeah, that was a great opening sequence there. So he ends up choosing his team, four of the students. So he chooses Henry Lowe, who you just saw there in the hot spot. Notice the hot spot is in his own house. I mean, that was unique about the community that nurtured these students. It was very much a family kind of event. They didn't have the tryouts at just, you know, one classroom. They had it at Tolson's house. So it establishes that kind of connection. So anyway, Henry Lowe, with an E, becomes one of the members, beautifully played by Nate Parker. And he's very brash and outspoken and arrogant. And then Samantha Book, with an E, beautifully played in this production by Journey Smollett. She's the only woman on the team, so she's chosen, later becomes the actual historical third woman to be a black attorney in Texas. And then, of course, James Farmer Jr., who is this amazing 14-year-old prodigy with this very strong work ethic that's handed down from his father, played by Forrest Whitaker. It's very unusual. You have Denzel Washington in this film, Forrest Whitaker, and then the fellow who plays the 14-year-old James Farmer is named Denzel Whitaker. No relation to either one, but he takes the first name of one, the last name of another. So very, very strange. So, and you can see how he is mesmerized with Samantha already. And that is what's unique to this film, too. It's not just about debate. It's about the triad between them. And because he's so young, 14 years old, it doesn't work that he would be a romantic love interest for Samantha, but Henry is. And that provokes a little bit of animosity between them, but not enough to destroy their relationships. But it does make an emotional connection between the three of them that you are fascinated with in the course of the film. So let's get a look at another example of Tolson's, how he works his team. And notice what they do with this opening exercise. This is something that they could do in another classroom. I've done this, work with a bone prop on articulation, but notice how they set the scene here in this exercise for articulation. And then also it goes into another scene, and the N-word is going to be used in this, but you'll notice that it's used to combat racism, which is another central theme in this show. So this is Who's the Judge from The Great Debaters.
I speak.
Who's the judge?
The God!
Why is he God?
Because he is not to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who is your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why doesn't he exist?
Because he is merely a descendant fortune of truth I speak.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he desires to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who's your opponent?
Why does he not exist? Because he is merely a descendant fortune who not speak.
Who's the judge?
The judge is God. The judge is God.
Why is he God?
Because he is not to win or lose, not my opponent.
Who's your opponent?
He doesn't exist.
Why does he not exist?
Because he is merely a descendant fortune who not speak.
Speak the truth?
Speak the truth.
Yes, sir, I do like to talk.
Is that a virtue or a vice?
Well, I have to admit, I've always wanted to be the quiet, mysterious type. Only I couldn't keep my mouth shut long enough.
Would you punch yourself in a street fight, Mr. Burgess?
No, sir.
Then don't punch yourself in a word fight. You don't have to make fun of yourself. Use your humor against your opponent. Mr. Farmer.
Yes, sir.
Happy Mr. Farmer. Tell us one thing we don't know about your father.
He was the first Negro PhD.
One thing we don't know about your father, Mr. Farmer.
He walked from Florida to Massachusetts to go to college at Boston University. He graduated magna cum laude.
Mr. Lowe. Tell us about your father.
Why don't you tell us something about your father?
We're trying to get to know each other, Mr. Lowe.
I was trying to get to know you, Mr. Tolson.
Well, I'm not the one on the debate team.
Are we not engaged in a debate right now?
All right. I'll take the affirmative. Take the meanest, most restless nigger. Strip him of his clothes in front of the remaining male niggers, female niggers, and nigger infants. Tar and feather him. Tie each leg to a horse facing an opposite direction, set him on fire, and beat both horses until they tear him apart in front of the male, female, and nigger infants. Bullwhip and beat the remaining nigger males within an inch of their life. Do not kill them, but put the fear of God in them, for they can be useful for future breeding. Anybody know who Willie Lynch was? Anybody? Raise your hand. No one? He was a vicious slave owner in the West Indies. The slave masters in the colony of Virginia were having trouble controlling their slaves, so they sent for Mr. Lynch to teach them his methods. The word lynching came from his last name. His methods were very simple, but they were diabolical. Keep the slave physically strong, but psychologically weak and dependent on the slave master. Keep the body, take the mind. I and every other professor on this campus are here to help you to find, take back, and keep your righteous mind. Because obviously you have lost it.
That's all you need to know about me, Mr. Lowe. Class dismissed.
Was that a lesson or what? I mean, I'm sorry for the excessive use of that N-word, but it's done for a reason. It's to bring this boy out of his immaturity and arrogance to focus him on what's important, which is to combat racism. And the way they're going to do it is by making their debate team succeed and draw some focus to excellent achievement by black students. That's Tolson's mission here, and he achieves it. In fact, unfortunately, in this film, there is a lynching. It's a horrible moment when the speech team has to witness it, and it almost destroys them. But in fact, it makes them stronger. It makes them bounce back and go on to that moment that I was saying about fighting at Harvard, which is a great conclusion to this film. But yes, finding your righteous mind, that attack that Denzel Washington had to do as Melvin Tolson was truly not just a style of teaching. It was a measure of his deep commitment to helping others. So it's for that reason, perhaps, a wonderful film. So they go on and they actually are able to have a dance where James imagines himself dancing with Samantha, but instead he sees her walking out with Henry, so there's that animosity grows. He actually witnesses Tolson, who's working with local sharecroppers to unionize. This was the 1930s. So that becomes a part of it as well. The sheriff starts trying to hunt down the leader of this union. Finally, they get to go to their first debate, and they are asked to basically defend the idea that the federal government, after the Depression is over in the 1930s, should continue unemployment compensation. So notice how wonderfully Nate Parker is, for instance, in his articulation and his vocal tone, and notice the montage that happens afterwards to show how the team not only wins this debate, but wins a number of others. So this is the debate and the winning streak from the great debaters.
A brilliant young woman I know was asked once to support her argument in favor of social welfare. She named the most powerful source imaginable: the look in a mother's face when she cannot feed her children. Can you look that hungry child in the eyes? See the blood on his feet from walking barefoot in the cotton fields? Or do you ask his baby sister with her belly swollen from hunger if she cares about her daddy's work ethic?
He's good.
She don't know more, you gotta step it up and go, yeah.
Eating at the best diet. Only thing that matters is that big fish eat little fish, and the color of the fish does not
step count. Up and go.
Got a little girl, but the state of Mississippi would turn their heads each and every time a Negro was lynched. Shouldn't the federal government intervene?
Yeah, go. We can't stand that, I pray. You gotta step it up and go. Shut, back door two, blindfold down, what you gonna do? You gotta step it up and go, yeah, and go. We can't stand pat, I clear, you gotta step it up and go. Got a little girl, her name is Ball, give a little bit, but she took it all. You gotta step it up and go, yeah. Me and my baby walking down the street, telling everybody about the chimney police. You gotta step it up and go. step it up and go. When I sing this verse, ain't gonna sing no more. Hear my gal call, I got...
That's right, Captain. Think I got the ringleader.
See that wonderful collage, how that worked, that you could splice all of those images and photos and some live action as well. That worked beautifully. In a short amount of time, you cover all the months of speech competitions that they won. So eventually, they get to the point where they can go up against a white college, and they're going to not go on campus. They have to go to this tent to debate, I think it's Oklahoma City College. And now we're going to get to see Jurnee Smollett as Samantha, show a rather fiery performance when she has to argue for the inclusion of black students into state colleges. Remember that at this time, it was all segregated. So you had black colleges, and the state colleges basically were all white students. So she's arguing to integrate that. Notice just, you know, how the use of the tent works so well here, and how the panning of the camera kind of keeps the whole audience alive. But yeah, this is a beautiful performance that you'll where you'll see her passion. So this is the debate against the white college from The Great Debaters.
In Negro would hereafter be capitalized.
To force upon the South what they are not ready for would result in nothing but more racial hatred. Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, he's perhaps the most eminent Negro scholar in America, he comments, "It's a silly waste of money, time, and temper to try and compel a powerful majority to do what they are determined not to do."
My opponent so conveniently chose to ignore the fact that W.E.B. Du Bois is the first Negro to receive a PhD from a white college
called Harvard. Dr. Du Bois, he adds, "It is impossible for a Negro to receive a proper education at a white college."
The most eminent Negro scholar in America is the product of an Ivy League education. You see, Du Bois knows all too well the white man's resistance to change. But that's no reason to keep a black man out of any college. If someone didn't force upon the South something it wasn't ready for, I'd still be in chains and this book here be running for my own massa.
I do admit it. It is true. Far too many whites are afflicted with the disease of racial hatred. And because of racism, it would be impossible for a Negro to be happy at a Southern white college today. And if someone is unhappy, it is impossible to see how they could receive a proper education. Yes, a time will come when Negroes and whites will walk on the same campus and we will share the same classrooms. But sadly, that day is not today.
As long as schools are segregated, Negroes will receive an education that is both separate and unequal. By Oklahoma's own reckoning, the state is currently spending 5 times more for the education of a white child than it is spending to educate a colored child. That means better textbooks for that child than for that child. Oh, I say that's a shame, but my opponent says today is not the day for whites and coloreds to go to the same college, to share the same campus, to walk in the same classroom. Well, would you kindly tell me, when is that day gonna come? Is it gonna come tomorrow? Is it gonna come next week? In 100 years? Never? No, the time for justice, the time for freedom, and the time for equality is always right now.
What a wonderfully passionate performance. But did you notice that what Samantha Book does is use logic to argue her point, and then she brings in the passion, talking about the 5 times. I want to show you one more clip just to give you a little look at Denzel Washington and Forrest Whitaker in this. They have a celebration at their homes to thank the team for winning that debate, which they win. And we get to see them kind of argue over what the Denzel character, Melvin Tolson, has been doing with James, because he fears that he's getting him involved in his organizing, the union organizing activity. So this is a small clip of Farmer Sr. with Tolson from The Great Debaters.
Yes, I did, honey. Nobody knows that better than you. No, I'm fine. How you doing, Pearl?
Help me.
Yes, I do. Where's your husband?
He's in the study.
Okay. Dr. Farmer.
Congratulations, Milton.
Thank you.
You have put us on the map.
Well, your son is doing a great job. His research is impeccable.
That's good to hear. It's good to hear. Listen, there are people around town who aren't very happy with your off-campus activities. They're calling you a radical. In fact, I wouldn't be a bit surprised to find out one morning when I woke up that you were strung up to a tree.
They'd have to catch me first.
This is serious, Melvin. Very serious.
A hungry Negro steals a chicken, he goes to jail. A rich businessman steals bonds, he goes to Congress. I think that's wrong. Now, if that makes me a radical, a socialist, a communist, so be it.
Amen on that.
Jesus was a radical.
Careful.
Yes, he was.
Careful.
Jesus was a radical.
Mental institutions are filled with people who have confused themselves with Jesus Christ.
I'm not confused.
Oh, you convinced you Jesus Christ now? You convinced you Jesus Christ? You know what words do.
Okay.
Come on now.
Amen.
Don't want to confuse yourself with Jesus Christ.
No, I'm not confused. I'm convinced.
I'm not judging you. I'm just concerned about your methods.
What methods?
James was there that night, wasn't he?
He was not with me.
Is he involved with this?
Of course not. James, I've done everything in my power to keep him out of this.
To keep him out?
Yes.
What, does he want to be involved? You telling me he wants to
no,
be involved?
No, he doesn't. Maybe this is something you should discuss with him.
I'm discussing it with you right now, and I don't feel like I'm getting a straight answer
from
him.
No, you're getting a straight answer.
I think that you were there with him that night.
He was not with me.
He's a 14-year-old boy.
I understand that, James.
And I'll do whatever I have to do to protect him. You understand that, don't you?
Is anybody thirsty?
Here you are.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's a great moment when the wives show up and convince them that maybe this isn't the time to have this argument. But it is, like everything in this film, well debated. There's conflict that's at the center of everything, and the debate, the clarity is of that debate, is it rings very true. So if you haven't seen it, I hope you will give yourself a chance to enjoy The Great Debaters. It is a movie about triumph, but at the same time, it's about the fears that are conquered along the way to that triumph. So look forward to next week when we have our last broadcast on Lights and Sound. So thanks for joining in to Theater 100.